go to, I'm going to give you, let me turn it down a little bit, Joe. I'm going to give you the, it's going to be a series I'm going to start. I'm not going to start it tonight because I won't have enough time to really, really lay the foundation. I'm going to summarize it, and then I'm going to take a few services to break it down. What I'm going to talk about is the complete understanding of the last days. Now, I believe according to Galatians 6 and 6, and then you read that. Don't just hear me say Galatians 6 and 6. Go read it. It says that that if you are instructed in the word, then you must share all good things that you're instructed. I told you I believe in giving by obligation. In other words, I believe if you receive, you give. And I believe because you're receiving from this ministry, realize that we've put these free videos on YouTube for years, and I've just, and this video, we get all around the world. This message is blessing people all around the world. Everybody, I can't tell you how many calls and emails we get talking about how God is transforming people's lives, bringing deliverance and healing and restoration. And many people are saying they don't even have a word like that in their city. And so, which is something else that we're gearing up for to do some church planting. But anyway, if you are receiving from this ministry, the Bible instructs you to share or sow back into what is feeding you. So if I'm feeding you as a pastor, as a man of God, I don't care if you got a church or a pastor, but if you're coming to and receiving from our channel and receiving from these videos, which are being provided to you for free, then you are obligated to sow back and share back with this ministry because you are being fed. That's biblical principle. That's the principle of Galatians 6 and 6. Galatians 6 and 7 goes on to say, don't be deceived. God is not mocked. It's talking about sowing into a man of God. We use that scripture wrong. When whatever you sow into a man of God, that and that only shall you also reap. If you sow sparingly into who's feeding you, then you're going to reap sparingly. But when you are liberal to those who are sowing the spiritual food into you, then you will reap liberal. And so it's very important how you take care of an anointing, how you support the anointing and anointing that's sown into your life. Don't leave, and I'm not just talking about me, don't ever take men of God for granted, somebody who is anointed sowing that word into your life. Don't ever mistreat that or be common with that or feel that you don't have a part to play in their support. Because the Bible says if I sow into you my carnal, what is it that I reap your, if I sow into you my spiritual, what is it that I reap your carnal? In other words, we're supposed to have a reciprocating relationship. If you come to YouTube and you receive it from those videos, then the Bible obligates you to begin to sow back to sustain my life. If the spiritual word of God is sustaining your life, then the Bible says you must share all good things with me, meaning your natural things should sustain my life. That's how you build a relationship with a man of God, and that's how the anointing flows into your life. So that's why it's so important for you to understand obligation giving. I don't like all of the gimmicks and tricks and playing the games. I believe that if you've received the word, if yokes are being destroyed, if God is removing your burdens and your life is getting better, then that means you're receiving the word, the anointed word is breaking the yokes, and you have an obligation at that point. Tonight I'm going to give you the title, and I'm going to do a little summary just to get your mind working in that direction to connect a few dots. But it's called The Return of the Nephilim. The Return of the Nephilim. And this will be a teaching message. But the goal is to give you a complete understanding of the last days so you don't draw blanks. We're living in this time, so I want to show you. We're going to go deep. If I have the time and the Holy Spirit allows me, and don't change my message, sometimes he'll do that, change the message on you. But I hope I'll get a chance to really get deep. Now, go to Genesis 6. Thank you, son. Go to Genesis 6. Amen. Now, I'm not going to be long tonight. I'm just going to give you a summary, and hopefully I'll be able to pick up on that Sunday, Wednesday, until I get through. Amen. Now, everything about the last days, hold your fang in Genesis 6 and go over here to let's see. Keep your finger in Genesis 6 and go to let's see, Matthew chapter 24, and we're going to just look, I just want to look at a verse right there to give you a foundation, because we're talking about the last days, amen? So let's see what Christ was saying about the last days. Matthew chapter 24, and let's look at verse 37. Everything about the last days is in Genesis, which is really odd that it would seem like it would be in Revelations, but it's not. It's actually in Genesis. Revelations is describing what the repeat of Genesis 6 looks like. Catch what I'm saying. Revelations is describing what the repeat of Genesis 6 looks like. Let's say that again. Everything about the last days is in Genesis 6. Everything. Everything about what we're dealing with now. Everything about hybrid races, cloning, DNA splitting, splicing, homosexuality, lesbianism, perversion. It's in Genesis 6. And it's very odd that Genesis 6 is the crux of the whole Bible, but it only spends maybe a few verses explaining Genesis, what happened in Genesis 6. And I do believe purposely, I believe that was by design of who might have not translated it, but decided what parts of the Bible would be put together. The reason why I say that is because the book of Enoch describes accurately what happened in Genesis 6, but yet that book was left out. And so Genesis 6 is the whole focus of the last days. Amen. Now Christ alluded to Genesis 6 when he began to talk about the last days in Matthew 24, because they asked him a question: when would be the end of the world? When would be the sign of that coming? What would be the sign of that coming? He began to break down what the world would look like before he came. Come on, talk back. He began to describe to his disciples what the world would look like. Amen. So Matthew 24, verse 37. I just want to deal with that one part. I don't want to go too deep. He says, look at verse 32. Now learn the parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender, he putteth forth leaves. You know that summer is nigh. Now he's giving them an understanding of when he will come. Amen. So likewise, ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation, what generation? The one that see these things. Come on, the ones that see these things. What things? Well, it's in 37, verse 37. Y'all there? He says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. But of that day and hour, no man know it. Know not the angels of heaven, but only my Father. But as the days of Noah were, y'all got that? As the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. What he's saying is, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be when I come. As it was in the days of Noah. The generation that sees the way it was in the days of Noah won't pass away until they see the Son of Man coming. Come on, talk back to me. Of course, he wasn't talking about the generation he was talking to at the time, because they all did. He was talking about the generation that would see as it was in the days of Noah. So I told y'all before, ask the question, what was going on in the days of Noah? Amen. Because it's the key to everything. It's the key to everything. Lord, if y'all knew how great a key this was. This is so deep. It's so extensive that I don't know how much I'm going to get of this out. But I want to give you an understanding that we must say we must. We must. understand the days of Noah. Amen. Now go over to Genesis 6. I'm just summarizing tonight. I'm not going to get too deep. I'm just going to try to give you a little summary. This explains CERN. This explains everything that they're doing. Let me give it to you before I forget that part. Say CERN. I don't know if you don't know about CERN by now. I can't help you. I don't know where you've been. You ain't been studying. But you remember in Genesis 6 when the fallen angels, can we read it? But I don't want to forget this point. It's the point I'm making. Because I want to tell y'all, I try to tell y'all at the conference what some of y'all deserve, what CERN was. You remember when Genesis 6, the Bible says that the sons of God, which is angels. Right. And a lot of theologians try to say they were men. They're not men. They were angels. Because the same sons of God as it's translated in the book of Job. And Job translated them Elohim. They were angels. They were not men. Amen. At the time, the angels were the sons of God. You got what I'm saying? The Bible says that they looked at the daughters of, actually it was a plan of Satan to corrupt the bloodline, which comes from Genesis 3 when God judged the serpent and said that he would bite the heel of the seed of the woman. The seed of the woman would crush his head. Satan understood at that point that the woman will birth beings or humans that will crush his head. So his goal was to keep the prophecy of the Messiah from coming by corrupting the bloodline. Actually, the goal of Genesis was to create another race. Amen. He did it in Genesis 6. Yeah. When Satan corrupts the bloodline of humans, God destroys the world. Wow. It's happened a few times. Amen. When you saw cataclysmic judgment. Yeah. Oh, y'all. Wow. Come on, let's talk. So Satan's goal to stop the Messiah was to destroy or attack the seed of the woman. Now, not only to attack the seed of the woman, but attack the bloodline, knowing that the Messiah had to come through a pure bloodline. That's why God did not trust man to give the seed to the Messiah. Amen. The Bible said he found the virgin and the Holy Spirit came up upon Mary himself. Amen. Y'all don't want to talk about this. Are y'all there? Yeah. Bible says this thing that is done was done by the Holy Ghost. She was conceived by the Holy Spirit. I mean, the what was in her was conceived by the Holy Ghost. Say amen. Amen. Why? So his blood could be pure because the blood, by the time of Christ, the blood of all men was corrupted. We all have a little bit of everything. If you get your DNA, you'll find out you got a little bit of Europe and you got a little bit of this and that. And it's like you got predominantly, if you're African-American, you predominantly got I don't want to even go into that. That's too deep of a teaching, too. But you basically will say it will put you in Benin or get it. Get it from Ancestry.com. It won't give you the haplogroup, but it would definitely give you where you're from. Amen. Amen. Which most African Americans, if you're African American or Caribbean or any of the island nations, if you came here as slaves, your DNA is going to put you around Negro land, which is Ghana. Mainly Nigeria around Lagos and Benin, and that's where it's going to put you at. Okay, now, that's very important. I don't have time to go into that, but I just want to tell you that's very important to know. Say amen. Now, but the goal of Satan or the serpent at the time was to corrupt the seed, not just to corrupt the seed that was being born, but to corrupt every bloodline so that the bloodline would be so corrupted that God wouldn't be able to birth what he needed to birth to crush the head of the serpent. You got what I'm saying? But God in his infinite wisdom knew that man, he was showing man the sacrifice when he gave man, when he first gave Adam and Eve animal skins. He was showing them that the animals are a temporary holding place for true cleansing. I ain't got this, ain't got time to get in that. Now, so all throughout the generations of man, Satan was working on corrupting man. It took Satan 10 generations to corrupt man. From Adam to Noah, it was about 10 generations, and he corrupted man by the fallen angels. Amen. Now, the fallen angels are not Nephilim. Nephilim is the offspring of the angels mixing with human women, which the Bible calls them giants. That's the Septuagint, or the Greek translation of the Bible, call them giants or gigantos, or as they go on, they'll be called heroes. Think about this. Think about this. Remember, return of the heroes, the Nephilim. The giants, the book of Enoch said the giants were judged by Almighty God or the Father, and those fallen angels pleaded with Enoch to get the Father to stop his judgment, and the Father and Enoch said, no, it's been set because you were placed over man and you corrupted man. Wow. By what? What did they corrupt man by? Yes, having sex with the women, but what did they really do to corrupt man? Gave them knowledge. Okay, the knowledge was what we call science or technology. Y'all there? Science and technology is really the occult. I know it's hard for y'all to understand. It's power without God is what it is. Now, is this too much? Is this too much? So Enoch said the judgment is set. And remember, the Bible says that those angels, the first angels that lost their first estate, they are now reserved in chains. Toratus is where they were banished to. They were banished from this realm. They were banished from this realm to Toratus until the time of the end. Y'all got that? Now, the book of Revelations talks about the bottomless pit. I told y'all about that before. Now, so what Satan has been doing is, because the angels were banished, I'll give it to you like this. You remember when Jesus was talking about Lazarus and the rich man. And the rich man, Lazarus died, and he went to a place called Abraham's bosom. And the rich man died, and he went to, the Bible says, in hell he lifted up his eyes. The rich man began to plead with Abraham. And he was telling Abraham to allow him to go back and talk to his brothers and tell them that this place called Sheol or Hades or hell is real. But he said, they have Moses and the prophets. And if they really wanted to believe, they don't need to see this in order to believe. But then he said, plus there's a gulf fixed. Oh, come on. I'm trying to tie it up now. I ain't gonna be long. There's a gulf fixed. He said, now you cannot come to us and we cannot cross over to you. So there was something fixed where man could not cross back over. A gulf, a barrier, a wall. Come on, talk back to me. Now, so remember the goal is now listen, Jesus said it'd be just like in the days of Noah. So in the days of Noah, in Genesis 6, the fallen angels came down, had sex with those men. So that means that's going to be a return of these fallen angels. Come on. Did it not say just like in the days of Noah? So there'll be a return of the fallen, right? And the fallen will reveal the Nephilim, or the children that will be produced, and the children that's already here. Okay, I'll get into that a little later, the children that's here. I'll get into that later. That's why Jesus was saying, don't let me forget that point. I can't forget this point. I was talking about before that. Come on, help me get that point back. Right, gulf fixed. So they couldn't cross over. So God put a barrier so that spirit beings, come on, cannot cross into the natural world. You got what I'm saying? I told y'all before, the reason why the demon spoke out of the man in the tomb of Gadarenes that was cutting himself and said, was saying, Christ, you are unlawful. You are come here to torment us before the time. They understood that you weren't lawful in this realm unless you had a body. So the spirits was looking at Christ and saying, how did you appear with a body? Because you're not lawful, because we can't come. We can only possess. But we cannot manifest ourselves in this world except we have flesh, born of flesh and blood, right? So what Satan set out to do was to trick man with the knowledge of good and evil, which is technology, getting man to break down the God barrier. Is this too much?
This is why Revelation says that there was a bottomless pit that was open. And out of the pit came the destroyer, Apollyon, Abaddon. Now, we know there's not a bottomless pit because we know the earth has an end to it. If you go straight down, you'll end up on the other side. So it wasn't talking about a hole that didn't end. It was talking about an opening of a dimension where the spirits that are banished will come back into this realm, just like in the days of Noah. They ain't coming back from heaven anymore. They're coming back from the realm they were banished to. Oh, I hate trying to teach us sometimes. Come on, talk back to me. So you're being conditioned thinking that these same fallen angels that were worshipped in every culture. Talk back to me. Every culture worshipped them. Let me read Genesis 6 and I'll show you. Y'all, Genesis 6. Okay, say, just like in the days of Noah.
Just like in the days of Noah.
What does that mean? Same as. Just like what they did, we do. And the judgment, the same world judgment in the days that happened in the days of Noah with the flood. But this time the judgment is not because God gave man a covenant that he would not flood earth anymore, and the gays took it, the homosexuals took it, the rainbow. That was a sign that he would not flood the earth. So the next judgment is not water, but it's fire. Are y'all there? Come on, y'all there or not there? So I want to show you everything we're talking about. You can't understand Daniel, Revelation, no prophecies without this, because you won't know that the restoration of these fallen. Now, we're talking about fallen angels, and we're talking about offspring of fallen angels. You got what I'm saying? The fallen angels is what the Sumerians, not S-A, but S-U-M-E-R, the first Phoenicians, Sumerians, with the hieroglyphs on the wall, the first ones that had the, what's the language, Sanskrit language, they called them Anunnaki, the angels. They actually show on their wall spaceships. The reason why I want you to understand is that just like in the days of Noah, meaning the same technology. Amen. See, you think man is evolving into knowledge, but they had knowledge before. The problem is every time we find that old knowledge or ancient knowledge, the Smithsonian show up and take it. Every time they find a giant, the Smithsonian show up and take it. Why? Because the elite, which I'm going to get into, those that actually are the brotherhood of the serpent, which are the 13 bloodline families, come on, y'all. They actually want to dumb man down so man will be deceived into thinking that this knowledge that they see coming out the sky is new, or like man is getting smarter, when in reality, Egypt already had the knowledge and so did Babylon. Y'all there? Because they were worshiping the fallen. Is this too much? Lord, let me make my point here. Y'all there or not there? Yeah. Now, let me read. I was making a point. What was my point? CERN. No, we got y'all understand that part. Oh, this is what CERN is. The Bible says in Matthew, Jesus said, listen to me. Come on, listen to me. I'm giving revelation. This is just coming. It's pouring now. I'm trying to stop, but it's pouring. Jesus said, there's a place called outer darkness, where there is weeping, gnashing. Come on, a place called outer darkness. Now, I talked to y'all before when I taught CERN about CERN, is that the goal of CERN is to, of course, to break down the barrier, but also to harness darkness, which is called antimatter. This is the reason why they are about ready to persecute us out of existence, because the revelation that the Holy Ghost gives, men cannot be deceived with this revelation, so he got to stop us from doing this. Okay, now, so, see, we're giving up the secrets of the deception is what we're giving up. Now, say antimatter.
Antimatter.
Now, scientists, I didn't say it. Scientists said that even the smartest guy, the guy in the wheelchair that can't move, you know him, Hawkins, he said that antimatter, if you harness enough of it, or the goal of CERN is to punch through the barrier from, listen, from this realm to the dark world. The dark world that's out of darkness. So what man is doing through Satan or the fallen giving them the knowledge that they think is technology is they're doing for Satan what he can't do for himself. He cannot come in this world. So those angels that are reserved in chains and are in out of darkness, they want to get out of there where they've been banished and cross back into this what we call the material world. Are y'all there? So this is what this is why Satan has. Now, the bloodline families that are the richest people, and some of these are the royals and them type people, they can trace their bloodline back to the Nephilim. This is why they interbreed, because they have the same bloodline. Are y'all there? This is going to be a deep teaching. I see where I'm going. Now, can y'all handle what I'm saying?
Yes.
Now, so Satan's goal is to deceive man by saying, and listen, what have you been conditioned for since the invent of television? What have we been conditioned for? Always remember what television is conditioning us for. When television, before television, radio. During radio, there was a CIA psyop called War of the Worlds, where they didn't tell the people that it was a play on radio. The people panicked and thought it was real. The goal was to see how the people would respond. So if you go fast forward to the 80s, Ronald Reagan said the only thing that would make man give up his differences and all of his religion is if we get something coming from the sky. Then the world will become, come on, one, which is the new world order that the Bible speaks about, the one world government that the bloodline families are entrusted to bring to pass. Talk back to me. Are y'all there? So what we're being conditioned for, we've been conditioned for, is every movie is conditioning you for the same thing. For these beings to appear. Now, the lie is already being circulated. This is why they're going to persecute Christianity out of existence. From this lie, I'm going to tell you. The lie that's being circulated, and it mainly came from white folk, and I'll tell y'all why they said it. They said it because they know they're not Semitic people. But the lie is that, remember I said the fallen, the Anunnaki that the Sumerians taught was the fallen angels. Come on, talk back to me. They teach now that they created us. So the reason why we cannot find the missing link in the theory of evolution, where the missing link is how monkey went to man. Does it have to be a link in the middle? Because there had to be something that tied, or an event that tied man to monkey. These fallen angels, which I wish I had a hieroglyphs to show you, they're going to say they are the ones that created us. Y'all got that? Now, when they say that, they're going to say, they're going to teach, like every other religion of the world, the Gnostic gospel. The Gnostic gospel is the Bible turned upside down. And they're going to say that they are here to free us from the rule of the creator that basically went rogue. And so through that, that's actually when the Bible says God will send a strong delusion so they may believe a lie. That'll be a lie. One of the greatest lies, that we were created by these fallen angels. Y'all there? Now, once that happens, of course, there'll be no need for belief in Christ. And they'll be so hostile towards us because man, Bible says man want to believe it. They want to believe there's something else other than Christ. Look at what they'll worship. Look at what people will follow. People will follow anything. People will worship anything. Grass, they'll worship anything to keep from worshiping God. The Bible says in Romans, because they did not want to retain God in their knowledge, they became vain and stupid and worshiped beast. Worship the creature over the creator. That's why Egypt had all these bird head gods, and they was worshiping creature over creator. Now, those gods of Egypt were fallen angels that were worshiped. Talk back to me. Now, because the people that, which some of these are mainly the Germans and the Greeks, excavated Egypt, they lied about the true power that Egypt actually has. The reason why they lied about it, because the Caucasian races got in bed with these fallen angels. And that's why they have been ruling for the last 300-500 years. Because they are using the knowledge that the Egyptians used from the fallen angels. They're using the knowledge Nimrod used in Babylon to build Babylon. Come on, y'all. And so now they were able to build what? Great civilizations with the help of the fallen. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Now, let's read Genesis 6 before I just forget to read it, and then y'all think I'm making something up. Genesis 6, look at verse 1. Y'all there? Amen. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. Now, the book of Enoch said it was 200 angels that agreed. I think Azazel was the head angel that decided to do that. And they all agreed that they would do it. And I'm not going to get into the book of Enoch tonight, but I'm just giving y'all some. I'm telling y'all the book of Enoch is talking in depth about Genesis 6. And it says, and the Lord said, my spirit will not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120. Now remember, before this, Adam then was living to be 900 some years old. But after, listen, they began to mix with these fallen creatures, God cut their years to 120. I truly believe that when the Bible says days are short, and I believe our years was cut. That's why you don't see a person 120 now. Maybe 105, but you don't see the 120 no more. Come on, talk back to me. Sin cut your years short. I ain't got time to get into that. Now God is saying, because these beings, these fallen angels have done this and man has mixed with man, he's cutting the days of man short. Now, there were giants in the earth. Say giants in the earth. And also, there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that. So that's showing you that before the flood, there were giants. After the flood, the fallen did it again. Because God destroyed all flesh. But they did it again. So afterwards, because you don't realize what Genesis 6 is, you don't understand that the children of Israel, the humans, were fighting ites. The ites were giants. The Amalekites, they were giants. Come on, talk back to me. That's why God told them, when you go into the land, utterly destroy them. Now you see why the God of the Old Testament was so harsh. You think we talking about humans. He ain't talking about killing humans. He was talking about this wicked bloodline that was in the earth that hated his people because they were human. So we see all the way up to the time of David, he's going against giants. Talk back to me. So these giant races, and some of them were not just giants, but they were, remember I showed y'all, I think in Daniel, where they mixed with the Horites, they mixed with the fallen. So some of them may not have been giants, but their blood was mixed. So when God decided to destroy the earth with the flood, he wasn't killing people. what we consider people. He was killing. The Bible says Noah was the only one righteous. Now, we think of righteous as right living, which we know it wasn't right living because Noah was a drunk. Right. Noah was the only one whose blood had not been mixed with the fallen. Amen. Meaning, God could start over and bring generations out of Noah, which he did. Amen. Talk back to me. Amen. So that's why God destroyed the earth, because all the Bibles, I'll read it right here. I'll read it. Look at this. It says, there were giants in the earth in those days, also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, sons of God. So you know we ain't talking about human, because it would have said the sons of men, like it said the daughters of men. And they bare children unto them. The same became, listen, the mighty men, which are of old, men of renown. These are where we get the myths from. These Hercules myths. Zeus and all that. These are the men of renown that were worshipped the same way they worshipped Osiris, Isis. The men of renown, the word would be hero. This is why Marvel, they conditioning you with hero worship. Notice all the heroes are dysfunctional. I ain't got time to get into that. But they conditioning man, I'll tell you what. You remember, I don't know if y'all seen this, but you remember the movie Hancock. You remember when the girl was explaining, because he didn't know who he was, but she was explaining to him, to Will Smith, who they were. She said, we used to be called gods and goddesses. And she said, but in this time, we're called heroes, superheroes, men of renown. Because when you go back and you study, you will see that these giants were powerful. They had different powers. Is this too much? Oh, y'all. Is this too much?
No.
It's too much what Wednesday?
No.
I'm trying to help you. See, and this is the reason why these preachers are doing such a disservice by not studying and having the Holy Ghost. Because they can't get revelation. And so people don't, the very thing we should be shunning, we're actually embracing. Yeah. Listen to me. When it says the very elect, if it's possible, the very elect will be deceived. The very elect. Then you got to understand that what's coming is so deceptive that those who believe in God, talk back to me. And we're being conditioned for it now. How are we being conditioned? Because we keep lowering the standard of the word of God to accept. To accept everything which is dull in our senses, meaning we're not sharp anymore to sin. Let me get done. Look at this. And God saw, verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Now, this is because man had mixed his DNA. Amen. See, Satan is building a bloodline. That's why I'm trying. I gave y'all the parable that Jesus gave them in Matthew of the weeds and the wheat. And people think the weeds and the wheat is just about good people and bad people. It's not what it's about. The weeds and the wheat is about. Can I go here? The weeds and the wheat is about. Remember, I said the weeds look like the wheat when it's immature and small. It's called actually the word there is darnel. That's the weed that grows and it looks like wheat. What say that parable was about? Remember, the servant said, "Well, let's go out there and snatch up the wheat, the weeds," and The master said, no, because you'll snatch up, you might harm the wheat. He said, they both must grow together, meaning they'll be living amongst each other. You're not going to be able to tell who's who till the time of the end, and the angels will separate them. Man ain't going to, we're not going to be able to separate. The angels will have to separate. Because we don't have enough discernment of who's who. Because you're not necessarily talking about what we consider good and evil or people that do good and bad. Because the weed look like the weed. You won't know the difference. We're talking about DNA. Oh. That parable is the climax of Genesis 3. When he said that the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman going to be battling. The seed of the serpent ain't coming as the seed of the serpent fighting. He's sown amongst the seed of the woman. Till the time of the end. Is this too much? So as we get close to the end, you're going to realize what we're really talking about here is actually DNA. We're talking about blood. The Bible says, Jesus said, life of the flesh is in the blood. So Satan, through the fallen, remember, it'd be just like in the days of Noah. So now the splicing and splitting and creating hybrid creatures. Now, if you look at Revelations and you see, what's all these funny creatures that had a man face and woman hair and another dragon teeth? What is all this? Well, this is what they were doing in the days of Noah. Well, what was created in the days of Noah? Let's see if you know. What did they create? Because the Bible said they sinned against bird and beast. They mixed up. This is what the fallen angels taught them, to mix DNA. Splicing and splitting. And they came up with stuff God didn't create. They took his creatures, spliced their DNA, and came up with other creatures. And the creatures were evil. So what were these creatures? Because the earth ain't number 6,000 years old. That's right. It was dinosaurs. Why you think man worshiped dinosaurs? That's what he created. These pterodactyls, these giant animals that eat. What did the Bible say? The fallen angels got tired and turned on man and start doing what? Eating men. So this is what these dinosaurs, these beasts, these were not God's creation. That's why they all, listen, died out at one time. I wonder when that was. They all died at the same time. This is why Darwinism came out to try to explain away the truth of the Bible. The truth of the Bible is solid. That's why they've been trying to refute it, but you can't. Because truth is just truth. So they tried to. So what they did was they took something and came up with a scientific theory. Most everything's a theory, meaning not proven, just this is what we think happened. The theory of evolution, we think it happened. And they came up with something called carbon dating, which can't be proven because you can only go back about 6,000 years. And then they start talking about millions. Well, you know they're lying when they say million years old, because they have to excuse millions because they have to give you the time of evolution. Man did not evolve. He was created. But in order to explain how you came out of nothing, they got to give you a million of years. So they put, it's called the antediluvian period. The prehistory. This is Genesis, prehistory. So what they consider, is this too much for y'all? So now you must ask yourself, ask myself. Who wrote history? Because if you scratch who wrote history, you'll find who's the liar and who the people. Who wrote that? You know somebody wrote it. Now, Josephus, the scholar Josephus said that the book, I believe it was Josephus, or it was one of the church fathers, said all the knowledge of the whole world was in the library of Alexandria. In Egypt. The reason why Egypt was so developed is because Egypt was the first culture that took the knowledge of the tree of good and evil through the fallen angels to the zenith, to the highest. They had it so down pat, they knew how to navigate death. See, before Christ came, you could navigate death. That was called the Book of the Dead. And they had to navigate death. because at that time there was no real torment. Death was just, you was just in a place. Come on, talk back to me. But when the law came, now this is pre-law. You know, Egypt was pre-law. When the law came and they found out and God hit the earth with the law, man had to be judged. Come on, talk back to me. Why? Because man now had what transgression really was. But before that, the Egyptians found out how to navigate death. Death is a spirit. Come on. Lord, I got to go. Is this too much for y'all? So this, now how did they learn that? They learned it from the fallen. They ain't the first ones that knew how to manipulate demons. Solomon found out how to do it. When Solomon started following them 200 wives, Solomon became the greatest magician. That's his 6-point star, as a matter of fact, that's on the Israel flag. It's the seal of Solomon. It's not David didn't have a star. It's actually the star of Rephaim. So that's the highest witchcraft symbol in the occult, is that 6-point star. That's why I never have it. Never wear it, never have it on. It's a curse when you put it on. Mighty funny, God, supposed to be God's people got that star as a symbol. That's a whole nother. That's actually the symbol of Saturn, or the symbol of the brotherhood of the serpent. The brotherhood of the serpent is the bloodline families that trace their lineage back to the serpent. Back to the serpent. You know how far that is? To the serpent. These are bloodline. The serpent mixed. I ain't got a whole nother teaching. Too much. Now, what was I saying before that? It was good. I went off on something. Josephus. No. He said that the knowledge of the world. So what did Napoleon and the Greeks do? What else did they do? Burned it down. If you go to Egypt, look, why did they chiseled all the faces off all the, why did they do that? They had not, they act like you can't read this stuff. They can read that stuff. I'll show you a hieroglyph of the Sumerians. You know, that's the most oldest culture. You know, who the Sumerians? Now, who the Sumerians? These are Abraham's people. Abraham was the Chaldean of the Sumerians. So these are Abraham's people. They were idol pagan worshipers. That's why God told Abraham, leave them alone. Get away from your people. Say amen. Amen. And then he cut a covenant, and Abraham was the first Hebrew. Amen. But remember, they destroyed the gods of his father. Is this too much?
No.
But the Samaria culture, or the Phoenician culture, they have the hieroglyphs, and the hieroglyphs you haven't seen are modern things we have now. I just saw a hieroglyph. I wish I could show you. I'll bring it. I'm gonna do a speech for a row of an atomic bomb and a nuclear explosion on a hieroglyph. I'm telling you that to show you, man did not evolve into knowledge. The fallen gave man knowledge. Talk back. So they had that knowledge already. When they found artifacts, they just steal it, take it, and hide it away. You never see it again. But they already had the knowledge. Now, is this too much? So all the knowledge of the world at that time was in the Library of Alexandria. Now, what knowledge did they have? They had all the knowledge. So that means the knowledge of the cult, the knowledge of death, the knowledge of all the witchcraft. They had all that knowledge. So what happened was, before white people, come on, gotta help y'all. They were cave people. Neanderthal people, the Goths and Visigoths up there in the cold Caucasus Mountains, they came down as barbarians, conquering the dark races, which had already had this knowledge. The knowledge, though, they had was the knowledge of fallen angels. That's why these barbarian white people was able to conquer. Because whenever God's people go into paganism, he raises up another people to conquer them. And so what happened was, the same way that God raised up the Assyrians to conquer Israel and lead them into Babylon. Talk back to me. Well, these barbarians that was up in them Caucasus Mountains interbreeding, the Bass people, I talked to y'all about that, up there interbreeding and stuff, that's why they got that Rh negative blood. They came down and were able to conquer because of the wickedness and the culture of the Babylonians and the Egyptians was at the zenith of their culture. They got into homosexuality and pedophilia, which... Now, I'm going to go off on a tangent. I got to go here. Do you understand why every culture without God, Satan leads them into homosexuality? You don't know. I'll give you a little part of it. I don't have time to go all. I got to give you some parts of it. Is this helping y'all a little bit? Yeah. The reason why homosexuality is initiation into the brotherhood of the serpent. That's why all the secret societies, they have to do the homosexual thing. It's not just an initiation. Homosexuality is the reversing of the soul. Come on. See, a person that's homosexual goes backwards from away from righteousness into rebellion. That's why they end up in such a deep, deplorable state, because it is backwards. They reverse themselves. When a person reverses themselves, their soul is wide open for any type of possession. That's the reason why Satan uses homosexuality. You want to know why is the culture becoming like this? This is the height of this Western culture, this Western empire. It's the height of it. Now see, I ain't got time to tell you, but see, the Europeans, the Germans and the Romans, and the Greeks didn't escape, but the Germans and the Romans and the France and Spain, they escaped the total annihilation that Egypt had, that happened to Egypt and happened to Greece. They escaped it, because you know, if you go look at Greece, they in ruins, all that's in ruins. But Europe escaped it. They got just some of it because in World War II, a lot of their cities got destroyed. But they escaped it by coming to the New World. Oh, come on. They came to the New World, and the judgment, see, they came over here and start building in this new land that was pure, didn't have no blood spilt in it. And so it took 250 years to judge this. It's too much. Lord, I don't know how to get out of it. Let me go back. I'm going too far. Come on, can y'all handle this? Okay, let's go back. Help me rewind. Where was I at? Let me rewind. No, it's too far. I'll pass him. I just said when I... Homosexuality. Okay, I didn't tell y'all. Did I not tell you? I didn't tell you. See, in occultism or Luciferianism, that's a better word, which is just occultism, witchcraft, you won't call that, but can I go? Now, I'm not trying to be lewd, but I want to tell you the truth, because I want to tell you what's the fascination with the butt. Is this too much? I'm trying, I want to help y'all. Now this tripped me out when I saw what it was, it all clicked all of a sudden what the fascination is. Even now with twerking, it's you don't even know what that is. But in occult and Luciferianism, they believe that I don't want to be lewd. Y'all ain't trying to be lewd. But I want you to know the rectum, that's a better word. The rectum is called the mouth of Satan. That's why when I taught y'all about, Baal, wasn't Baal worship? It was about Baal worship. That too. But because it's really just the same. But I taught y'all about Baal worship, and I said the feminized males would go to the temple, and they had to put their face to the ground, and they would put their face. I'm trying to tell y'all. So in Africa, some parts of Africa, you know, they were the best twerkers. You do know that. Go now. They got a beat. We ain't got. It's a beat. It's a beat. We ain't got. You know, we got rhythm here. I mean, we'll destroy white people, Mexicans, but boy, they got something. They got a beat. Another beat. It's another beat. But a lot of those tribal dances was the same thing they do in voodoo. And it surrounds the shaking of the butt. Because the shaking of the butt is conjuring. It's an invoke. That's why. Why you think Satan got people doing it? And believe it or not, they become addicted to doing it. They become addicted to doing it. Now, that's enough. I'm leaving. That's enough. So stop doing it. Is this too much for y'all to understand? We don't highlight the butt. Because the butt, I don't believe I'm saying this in church. Do y'all want me to help y'all or not? I'm trying to help you. It's a place of waste. Meaning nothing productive. It's all dead. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? So that's why Satan turns us aside. That's the ultimate rebellion. It's for a man to take life and put it in a dead place that cannot produce life. It's the ultimate rebellion against God. And that's why at the height of Egypt, see, they lying to y'all about Egypt. Y'all don't know Egypt got fag hieroglyphs too. They don't show y'all that. They don't want y'all know the height of the culture of Egypt was homosexuality and pedophilia. It's in their pyramid text. That stuff's been translated. It's in a pyramid text where I believe it was Akhenaten. He had to make a law for the men not to have sex with the boys, because that's how bad it was. The same thing that the Greeks did. Where did they get it from? They got it. The Greeks took the Egyptian religion. They stole the books and started worshiping the fallen angels. But if you worship them, you have to serve them by defiling of your temple. So they had to get it. The Romans took the culture from the Greeks when they conquered them. Y'all got what I'm saying? The Greeks took the culture from the Babylonians. The Babylon was when took it from Genesis 6. Y'all talk back to me. So all throughout history, it's been Satan trying to pervert men. He thinks he's going to make it. He thought he had it during Hitler's time. He thinks he's going to get his Antichrist or his man of sin on the earth. But the conditions of the earth were not ready. Daniel said it really can't happen to the time of the end. Shut this book up to the time of the end. That's when knowledge. When knowledge shall be increased. Technology, men shall be to and fro, flying technology. When you see men moving fast through technology, that's when this time is. Amen. Oh. That's why Jesus said this generation ain't gonna pass away till they see the days of Noah. So we are the generation of the days of Noah. Are y'all there? Oh, Lord, I got to close. Come on, can I help you? So what I was saying was, I got to tie this up. So stop looking at this homosexual stuff as this new phenomenon. It ain't nothing new about it. Every culture did it, and every culture was destroyed doing it. That's why you don't see Pompeii. They got destroyed when they were at the height of pedophilia. It wasn't just homosexuality, it was really pedophilia. Can I talk back? Pedophilia is the original, satanic worship that they started in Babylon. It started in Babylon. Pedophilia is the reason why pedophilia is Satan's, what he gets society into, is because his goal is to destroy the innocent seed. He tries to defile the innocent. Why? He's only doing it for one reason. Genesis 3, the seed of the woman. If I can't get the woman to kill the child, then I'll defile her and the child, so it'll be so impure. It ain't thing about crushing my head. Now the problem is, every one of us through Christ, our head crushes. That's why he hates you. Because if you get to Christ, even though your blood is defiled, you gotta be born again. When you get born again, you qualify to walk in Genesis 3. He's biting on your heel, but you're crushing him. And every child, human that's born, has the head-crushing ability, so he wants to kill everybody. But I can't kill everybody, but I'm trying to defile. Why I want to defile you? So I can get my spirits in you and lead you away from being a head-crusher. So that's why he worked on you all your life. And that's why when you got born again, all hell broke loose. Family went crazy. Everybody went crazy. Why? Because them spirits were saying, we got a head crusher. And then there's a promise in the word that if you a head crusher, if you saved, then your whole house. So now we got a family of head crushers. So can you understand simple? This is a simple understanding of warfare. It ain't complex because y'all ain't complex because of this cosmic and this chakra Hindu Eastern foolishness. It's not complex. It's in Genesis 3. Satan knows that through the seed of the woman, meaning the woman birthing, the woman has the device to birth the will of God. I told y'all. Through the seed of the woman will come head crushers. Now, he thought he was going to stop the head crushing by killing Christ. But all he did was free Christ to birth more head crushers. So because I cannot stop those that are already head crushers by being born again into the head crushing family, he goes after trying to get the woman to abort the seed. This is what this abortion was. It's what this big thing is. But if I can't get her to abort the seed, then I will, by me destroying the family and getting the father, which has the authority out from over the children, I will get her to, she'll be so uncovered. That's what y'all women are without a head covering. You so uncovered that I can get different spirits. These are the sort of creep into the houses of silly women. I'll leave the whole house captive. Meaning I'll capture the children, arrest their destinies or their star. And then I will have them so perverted and messed up through rejection and insecurity that they'll spend 50 years trying to find out who they are. And that's 50 years that I distracted them from head crushing. That's why God wanted Abraham to raise his seed righteously, because they become head crushers at early ages. So that's why he fought you so hard, because he knew. Now, the end times is about removing you. You have to be removed. This is why Jesus said they're going to start a killing campaign to take y'all out of here, because the world can't be deceived. Let me show you how powerful you are. I'm done. Let me show you how powerful you are. You know, in the book of Revelation, the Bible says that we in the tribulation at that point. The killing campaign has begun. God's people are getting martyred, right? The Bible says they all but stomped out Christianity because there's only two witnesses left. Remember the two witnesses. The Bible says that, this show you how powerful a witness is, just in two preachers was left preaching. And they turned the world that day upside down. They were so powerful that God allowed them to be killed in the street. These men were so powerful that they made it a holiday when they died. They said they'd start passing out gifts when the two witnesses died. That's why he got to remove you, because any light at all. Remember, light shines into darkness. Darkness could never overcome it. So Satan can't leave one light. One light's too much. Y'all don't understand his. He understands one light. You don't believe me. You don't believe me? What was Paul? He was one light. We still talking about the light that he released. Come on. This is why you're so dangerous. But this is why he fights you so much. Because he know if you ever get in your righteous mind and you begin to walk in who you are, the light you have will affect your generation. That will reverberate down through generations. I'ma prove it to you. This is the reason why when you die, you don't get your rewards right away. Because all of the lights you put out is still reaping dividends. See all the light I put out. No, every word I put out there. It's reaping dividends. Amen. So he's trying to stop every light. This is why he fights you so hard. I'm trying to get you to understand it. Now to sum this up, to get to the end. This is why you ought to thank God that he predestined you to be born again. Amen. He predestined. There are those that go to church and there are those that are born again. He predestined me to be filled with his spirit. He predestined me. That means that now I'll prove that to you. Before I formed you in your mother's belly, I knew you. I knew who you should be to give you an expected. That means he knew me before. Now y'all gonna get this. This is set free. He knew me before. Before I formed you in your mother's belly, I knew you. Before I was in my mother's belly, ask the question. What question should you ask? Where was I? Where was I? Where were you? I was with him. Because in order for me to have found him now, I had to read. Now listen, I had to read. R-E means go back, return, repent, read. That means I had to go. So in order for me to be saved, he predestined me to be saved because I was with him before. If not, I wouldn't read nothing. Repent means to turn or return. If you die without returning, you're lost. So that's why he said, before I formed you in your mother's belly, I knew you. I knew. That's why I tell you life is ruined. Really, you don't know it. The reason why your life couldn't work out is because you was destined to know him. Now, I'll prove that. I got to go. I'll prove it. I'm going to show you. The reason why Christ is so great, and he's the only begotten, but he's really the first fruits, meaning he was the first one that re. Now, but when he came, he didn't know who he was. He was born like you, but he was with the Father too. Come on, talk to me. Well, if I was with the Father, why did he let me be born? Why did he just keep me with him? Because life was the greatest gift. Decisions was the greatest. Oh, yeah. The will is the greatest gift. He actually let me come here to be better. To have better, I have better reward. That's another talk. You're going to rule and reign. He's talking about authority that you'll have. But listen, when Christ came to this earth, he was born like you. He was born into this flesh. And this flesh had to develop the brain, the mind. He found out who he was. When he found out who he was, that's when he went in the temple. How old was he?
12.
He said, I must be about. Okay, because he found out who he was. Now, but before he went in, when he went in the temple, wasn't no miracles. No casting out no devils. Wasn't none of that. And his mama said, come on here. Come on home. Because he thought he knew it all like we do at 12. He had to go home. See, I had somebody get mad at me over this because they didn't understand that you being born in this flesh erases your memory. You don't believe it. Before I formed you, I knew you. What was you? You was with him. So let me bless you. You chose to come here. Why did you choose to come here? For greater. Why did Christ choose to die? For the glory. For the greater reward that he would get by going through. The greatest authority is given based on the greatest obedience. Listen, I'm done. I ain't gonna get no further. I'm done. Listen. So when Christ came to this earth, remember when he came to John the Baptist. John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God. Christ said, come baptize me. John the Baptist said, no, you baptize me. He said, no, it's got to be done this way. Now, I'm going to show y'all that Christ is where somebody got mad at me when I showed him. I'm going to show y'all Christ was learning. That's why the Bible said he learned obedience through the things he suffered. If Christ knew all the suffering, if he knew it all, then he would have not went to the Garden of Gethsemane and said, if there be another way. That don't sound like a person that is sure. He learned. Listen, can y'all handle this? He learned he was Christ. He learned it. If he didn't learn it, he couldn't have redeemed you. The same way you must learn who you are. He had to learn that. Because he, listen, I'm going to mess y'all up. He was, now don't get mad at me. Understand how I say this. He was not the Son of God. He was the Son of Man. He was the Son of Man. He called himself the Son of Man. It was important, y'all, for him to be man. He had to be man. And this is the reason why Satan has done everything in his power to distract and attack your life so you never understand or learn who you are. When God showed me years ago, I'm done, that, remember, I put it this way, I'll show you something. I don't have time to turn out, but I'm going to show you, I'll just tell you. I'm going to show you who you are. You want me to show you who you are? You know the Bible says that there's a name you're going to be given that nobody know? What's the name? The names in the Bible ain't like the name. We call each other TT and Riri, and we just make up stuff. No. Name in the Bible defines who you are. Your name is going to be who you are. It's going to be a function in the kingdom, in the next kingdom. Now, listen. I'm going to show you that you were somebody before. When Christ took James and John up on the mountain, Transfiguration, and he transformed. And basically he was showing, he wasn't really showing them, he was, they saw the glory that he had before, the royalty he had before. Now, he had that before. If y'all realize, your natural mind is so keeping you from understanding spiritual things, because you think you comparing the spirit with natural. That's why you can't understand. The laws of the spirit are not like the natural. The laws of the spirit are infinite, meaning in the spirit, this room is here, but there's more in here than this room. This room in the spirit is bigger than this room. You're bigger than this room. You're bigger than you are in the spirit. The laws of the spirit are not the same. So Christ spent most of his time, listen, getting men to divorce their mind. He getting them to divorce their mind, because it's your mind that stops you from believing. It stops the, I got to quit. So what he's doing is renew. Now there's another reword. Didn't say new, it said re. Y'all not reading the Bible. It said renew. Come on, talk to me. If you gave me a new mind, that means I didn't have it before. He didn't give me it. He said re. So to re means I must have had it before. I told y'all death ain't what y'all think it is. I'm trying to help y'all with this. You got to understand that this is what our education system and the carnality of this world has dumbed us down to the true power of the Word of God. And so even though we're reading it with the wrong understanding, and we don't really understand that what he was trying to get us to do. Why is the Bible saying you seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus now? Well, are you there? No. But how you, but well, how am I seated there? See, the goal is for, see the goal, see, listen, what we're doing, I got to close. What we're doing in the Holy Ghost, listen to me now, I'm going deep, I'm going to blow you away and I'm gone. What we're doing in the Holy, what the Holy Ghost allows us to do is what they doing with CERN. The Holy Ghost allows us to transcend what's keeping us from that realm. That's why Jesus said, it's finished. The veil, meaning the barrier between this world and that world, is ripped, but I must send you the Comforter. He's the one that can bridge this world and that world. If you get into that world without him, you're going to have to do it through another spirit, which is a cult of witchcraft. So if you get into the supernatural without the Holy Ghost, meaning the Holy Ghost, I'll show you something, I'm done. I'll keep saying I'm done. If you gotta leave, go. This is the Holy Ghost. Do y'all understand that? This is the Holy Spirit. If the plug is God, this is what the Holy Ghost is. I'm away from God, can't talk to God, can't hear God, but once the Holy Ghost has come, I'm connected to God, meaning I can now receive signals from the other side. If I receive signals and they got the white of the Holy Ghost, they don't color, nothing on color, I'm just scenario. And don't got the Holy Ghost, and I receive a signal from the other side, it's coming through darkness. It's coming through darkness. And if the light in you be darkness, what is light? Come on, what is light? What's light synonymous of? Light, revelation, knowledge, light, wisdom. So if the spirit you connected to be darkness, all the light you're going to get is going to come from darkness. This is what they call in knowledge in this world. So that's why the Bible says that God confounds the wise. Because they think, okay, let me help you better. Remember when Jesus came and he said, you say you see. You say you see. I can't help you. Because the light that you're seeing by is darkness. So a man must be born again of water and spirit. So that when he plugs in, this is what happened to you when you got saved. Literally, you got, he plugs you into the spirit. And what happened when you got plugged in? What happened? Your eyes came open. The same eyes you had, but all of a sudden you could see what you couldn't see before. Because you were illuminated. So the fallen have gotten bloodline families that are called the Illuminati. But they lit up by darkness. Who is the prince of darkness is the light bringer. Lucifer. Lucy is light. Anytime you see loose, L-U-C in front of a word, it's a derivative of Lucifer. Lucent. So they lit up by Lucifer. Lucifer has taught them what did Lucifer teach them? What did he teach Eve? The tree is wisdom or light. The tree is light. Remember, he told her the tree is going to illuminate you and make you wise. So she received the darkness. And how great was the darkness? So the Bible says men love darkness because their deeds are not seen. But we are children of the light. So to sum up your walk with Christ, he's trying to get you to walk in the light as he is in the light. But you can't walk in the light without being connected. Without being connected by the Spirit. This is how you lead and guide in all truth. The Spirit is the conduit. Listen, it's a living conduit. Connected me to the Father. Without this right here, you are still in darkness. And you won't even be able to understand the light. This is the reason why if you try to talk to people about the light without the Spirit, it's almost like you're going to be mad at them after a while because they're not going to get it. Let me show you how this works. Oh, Lord, I got to go. The Bible says that Nicodemus came to Christ by night. By night. And he was trying to talk to Christ about, and Christ said, Nicodemus, come on. You won't even see unless the man be born again. You won't see. You can't see the kingdom. But Nicodemus, because all he had was the light of the world. The light of the world, which is the gnosis or the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, he interpreted the light that Christ gave him, which was born again. Christ said, you got to be born again. That was revelation. That was light. But because he didn't have it, he interpreted by the light of the world. Well, what do I need to go back in my mother's womb? He said, Nicodemus. No, why you can't hear me, Nicodemus? Because you full. The light that's in you is darkness. And even when you hear, so that's why y'all trying to get people say, and you don't know, why can't they hear me? Because they full of this. And the darkness is reinforced by Beyonce and by Jay-Z and by these rappers and by the movies and by all of the worldliness that's keeping them receiving wisdom from darkness. And so when you try to come with the light, they crowded over by the darkness. They can't hear what you're saying. That's why I'm trying to get y'all to learn to really worship God, because I'm thanking him. Listen, that I have ears to hear. My eyes have not grown dull. My ears have not grown dull. That I have the ability to hear what the Spirit is saying. Do you know how powerful that is? In this dark world, I can hear what the Spirit is saying. No matter how much deception or error or erroneous doctrine, I can hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Why? Because I'm walking. So let's reinterpret it. He who is led by the Spirit of God, they are the ones connected to God. Stand on your feet. I got close. I'll keep going revelation on that. I'll keep pouring it out of that. That's why I said nothing's more precious than the Holy Ghost. He is my true connection to the Father. You can fool me with this Bible. You can fool me if you want to. You know how many cults started with this book? You can fool me. You can get me over into Buddhism. You can get me into Hinduism, New Age. You can do a lot of things. If I don't have the light to hear you rightly divide this, you can tell me to say anything. But you can't fool me in the light. Why? Because light makes manifest. Light makes manifest. This is the reason why everything, even when you stand before Christ at the mercy seat, even those that are at the judgment seat, which is the white throne, which I don't want to go there. That ain't where we're going. We're going to the mercy seat. You're going to be judged with light. You don't believe me. The Bible says that when he tried you, your works, they're going to be tried by what you think fire is far on this earth. No. Fire is lightning. I saw Satan fall like it ain't fire, it's lightning. So what's fire? Let's see if y'all really know. What's fire? Electricity. See, the technology of electricity is why, see, that's why Satan won't let man move beyond electricity. We could have been on some other energy. You do know that. Electricity is how he bridges the gap in the spirit world. I don't got time to talk about that. That's too deep. But light is like lightning. So when you stand before Christ, all of your little stuff you did, he going to try it. What is he going to really do? Let's see if y'all know what he's going to do. Because you're going to stand before Christ. What are you going to do? He just going to cut the light on. Where the light at? Let's see if you know. Where's the light at? Where's the light at? No, Christ the one got the light. Where is it at? Let's see if you know where the light. Come on now, this ain't no trick question. Where is the light? Where did John the Revelator say the light was? What did John the Revelator say his light was? When he turned around and seen him, what did he say? He had his eyes were like flame. That's what's going to burn. When he look at you, he going to look on your work. Pure. He's so pure. See, this is what we got to understand is that my goal ain't to run my race against you, or I ain't comparing myself with you. I'm comparing myself with this book. This book, because I want to make it to heaven, but I want my works. I want to have some good works. I don't want my works to burn up because my motive was wrong. So remember I told y'all about the Shekinah? What's their mission? Put out the light. The end times is all about light. And this is the reason why they strike the sun in its darkness. The end time, they're going to turn the whole earth to darkness. They striking the sun. They some worshipers, but they really hate the sun. They're going to strike the sun because they truly hate the light. This is where the vampire myths came from, where they hate the light. Those beings that I got close. Yeah, I start talking to y'all. I got close. those things they call alien graves, those are offspring of Nephilim that's in the earth. They here now. They here now. That's why every culture describes them with these big eyes and big heads and they run around naked. Oh, y'all ain't ready. Y'all ain't ready. That's too deep. I'll take y'all there later. That's too deep because then y'all be going home saying, what did he mean by that? And I don't understand that. And I don't understand that. And that's why I try to tell y'all, y'all need to hear that message I preached in Baltimore about dreams.